Down to the river, down to the river, down to the river. you loved us when we were unlovable, Jesus. Thank you, Father. Think that I want to say, come on, thank the Lord, everybody. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. What do we have to be thankful for today? Come on, tell him. Gracias, Señora. Gracias, Señor. Te damos gracias. Gracias, Señor. Gracias, Señor. Gracias, Señor. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for all. Father, we thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Amen. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Otra vez. At this time, I would like just to thank my brother Luis Rios. He lives in Pico Rivera. It was my birthday last week, right? So he bought me this beautiful acoustic electric guitar. Look at this. Epiphone, made by Gibson. And what a blessing. God is so good. I needed another guitar like this, and the Lord told him to buy me one, and he did, and I'm so grateful for it. And I will also give a shout out to all my brothers and my family in Indio, from Pepe too, from Merced. I came from Merced. Hopefully they're watching right now. My brother Jose, my brother Carlos, Luis, Linda, Araceli, Debbie, the Rios familia. Hope you're all watching, and we just love you so much.
Thank you, guys.
I hope it blesses you.
Love for me. Who
the sun sets free, oh, is free indeed. I'm a child of God, yes, I am. My Father's house, in my Father's house, there's a place for me. I'm a child of God, yes, I am. I'm a child of God. I'm a child of God, yes, I am. Come on, I'm a child of God. I'm a child of God, yes, I am. I'm a child of God. I'm a child.
Man, I'll tell you what, Juan, you are, and Nellie are such a blessing. Man, I thank God for you guys, and man, we are tremendously blessed. Good morning, everybody. Man, I just can't stop talking about Juan and Nellie. You know, they just so fun and loving, compassionate, kind, and all the other good stuff, you know. You know, I know many of you out there are, but boy, you know, I would love to have you, one of you, come on sometime and share your testimony, and for the glory of God to be able to come on and just share. Praise God. And hey, so let me just say welcome. God bless you, everybody. And we're so thankful that you joined us. I'm just checking the time because I want to make sure that, you know, that I move forward and bring the word of the Lord and the message. But before we do, of course, you've seen on there that it was birthdays for, of course, for Juan. But also, you know, I think it was also, well, my brother Joe, birthday, Donna, I believe. I think it was Donna's birthday recently also. And Sal Rodriguez, it's Sal's birthday. He finally caught up to me. Don't tell anybody, but Sal is, he is now 65 years old. You know, I had you know, if you go on Facebook, you'll see a picture I had posted of Sal Sal as a little dude. Watch, I think I just found it. Let me see if it'll put on here. Check it out, everybody. This is Sal Rodriguez on the left and me on the right. 1965 at Telfair Elementary. So Sal, God bless you, brother, and happy birthday to you, Sal. We praise God for you. And then, of course, I got to give a special shout out to my boy, my grandson, Noah. Man, it's his birthday. Let's see if I could put his picture on here. There you go. Look at that. Noah, boy, he is such a cool kid. Man, I'll tell you, he's such a cool kid. You got to love him. Today, he actually, for his birthday, he was asking for support. And so today, he actually, for his birthday, he wanted to go out and feed the homeless. And, you know, for those of you that donated, that knew about it, thank you so much. That's what he wanted to do for his birthday. He said he wanted to give out money. And so I know that we contributed and some of you contributed, but This is the heart of Noah. He's such a blessing. I love this kid. I love all my grandkids, but boy, Noah just seems to have a real heart. They all do. But Noah really, for his birthday, he wanted to be a blessing to the community, homeless in particular. And the other thing he wanted to do was to not only make sandwiches and bring them sandwiches, but he wanted to go ahead and give them money. So he was kind of, they were making sandwiches and then attaching, I don't know, $5 or $10, something like this, you know. That was just something that he wanted to do for his birthday. Of course, recently, our brother Lilo had passed away, and we dedicated a service to him a couple weeks ago. But even Lilo, there's the other picture of Noah, but Lilo used to do a lot of homelessness ministry and go out into the community. And of course, some of you were a part of that. Many of you actually in Faith Center were a part of that. Let me see, I'm gonna drop in one more picture. Man, look at this. Grandpa sharing pictures, right? Of, there's Noah, myself, and Nevea. But today, that's what he wanted to do, was go out and share, you know, with the homeless, to bless them, give them something to eat, remind them that they are thought of and loved. And so we thank God for that. Here's the last picture. Okay, bear with me. I know that if it was you on this, then you'd be putting your grandkids' pictures and all that. But check it out. Hey, the Tony Maldonado. There, take a look at these pictures. We always kid around because, you know, times when we'd be on vacation, we Annette would pull out her cell phone and show her grandkid pictures, and then Laura and Tony try to take us through a three-hour tour of their grandkids. You know, I'm only kidding. Happy birthday, Noah. Let's say a word of prayer, everybody. Thank you for indulging me and allowing me to just go on there. Well, Father, today I pray, God, for everyone out there that is facing tough times, difficult situations in your life. We pray now that by the Spirit of God, that the Lord would move in a powerful, powerful way on your life, in your home, with your family. Father, I come against every foul, wicked, evil, lying, tormenting, deceiving, unclean, demonic spirit now, Father, sicknesses, diseases, Lord. We thank you, Lord, that, Father, you are the healer. You are the restorer of lives. And so now we pray for you now in Jesus' name. I pray today that the Lord will give us hearing ears, seeing eyes, and an understanding heart to be able to take in, comprehend the Word of God. And Father, I pray for those that have lost loved ones. Father, those that are mourning and those that have suffered this losing family members, Father. We pray for Lydia Aguilar's family. Lydia, who used to be part of our church many years ago. We lift up her family now in the name of Jesus. For those that are out there that, man, you're recovering and from a sickness, we just pray, we set ourselves in agreement with you now, believing that God, amen, will move in your life, in your situation, in your circumstance. Like we always say, God is a right now God. Not, we don't always say it, but He is a right now God. Amen. All right, so let's go ahead and we're going to, you've seen that I put a little flyer on there to prepare for the what was I saying? Prepare for the communion. Let me see. So I'm going to put it up there. Communion Sunday. So that's what we're doing now. So let's go ahead. And right off the top, let's go to the table of the Lord in communion. For those of you that are ready, just grab a tortilla or something, whatever you got, a piece of bread or some water or some juice. Some of you may want to grab some Kool-Aid, I don't know. But whatever you do, praise God, let's go to the table of the Lord. The Bible tells us that in the same night that the Lord was betrayed. Listen to that. Man, what a powerful, powerful concept. Not only concept, but the Lord that in the same night that he was betrayed. Whoa. He's still, as he's doing communion, he took the bread, which he took, he lifted it. He said, gave thanks for it. And he said, take ye, eat of it. This is my body, which is broken for you. So now let's partake and let's go ahead and take. This is a little piece of actually fortune cookie. And yes, honey, I did sanitize somewhat there. But this is a fortune cookie, but it also said that something good is, the little fortune said, something good is coming to your house. I'm like, all right, I'll take it. Let's take in the name of the Lord. Thank you, Father, for the breaking of your body. You were bruised, battered, and you were buried. But Lord, you were also raised up. Your body gave us the power of the resurrection. So we thank you now in Jesus' name. Amen. Go ahead and take. Well, I don't know where in the heck I hear like an echo, but let me see. Here we go. Okay, so we give thanks for that. And now we take of the cup. And Father, we thank you for the cup that was shed. The blood, Father, that was shed from your veins. Lord, we thank you now in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Father, that you sent your Son into this world to redeem, to reclaim, to restore. And Lord, you did it by the breaking of the body of our Lord Jesus, and you tore the wall down that separated us, but you shed the blood to cleanse us, to purify us. You shed the blood, Father, and in that blood, we thank you that we are made whole. In Jesus' name, Jesus also mentioned, take, drink of this cup. And he also said that he would do it with us again in the kingdom. So take it in the name of Jesus. Amen. All right. Wow. All right. So, hey, God bless you guys once again. And just checking to see how much time I got left. Thank you, everybody, for tuning in today. And I just want to encourage you to stay tuned. Don't tune out, man, because I know that sometimes, you know, it's easy for us to tune out right away. I just want to thank you for checking us out. Not only checking us out, but joining us as a community of faith online, you know. We're assembling together in your living room and your bedroom, wherever you're at, in the car. Yesterday I was with the Brewliners online, and man, they're all over the place. Some are in the living room, on the car, on the street, walking here, there, but wherever you're at, we are gathered together in Jesus' name. And today, you know, last week I started a message, on the image and the likeness of God, that we are created. In the image and the likeness of God. And so it is important for us to understand this. that we have been created in the very image and the likeness of the Lord. Amen. And so that's important for us to understand that. We already seen in Genesis 1:26 that the Bible says that God said, let us make man in our image and in our likeness, after our likeness. And then he gave them a dominion, said, be fruitful, multiply. And so that's what began to happen. But before they began to be fruitful, they ended up messing up. Genesis 1:27 says, and God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him, male and female, he created them. And so we know that this is what the Lord did, that he created us in the likeness, in the image and the likeness. And so right now, I just want to say, you know, something that's important is this. Image and likeness. You know, sometimes when you look at your kid, you'll say to him, man, you look just like your daddy. You look just like your mama. That's the image. But and then you're going to see where there's a likeness. Well, your personality, the way you talk, the way you do certain gestures, man, you're just in the likeness. That's the difference. Image, likeness. The image and the likeness of God. So the Lord really, it was a reflection of himself. So that really the reality is God is looking on the earth. He's seeing a reflection of his very image and his likeness being reflected back. There was an old timer, Bezalel, let me see, I'm going to say Bezalel, anyways, Bezalel, the great, you know, and this guy, you know, a bishop way back in the 330 AD, this guy here, this cat that you can see here. Now, the reason that I want to share, and I'm sharing that, is because, one of the things that's important is, like, the closer we were to the creation and the fall of man, if you will, or the partaking of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. So something happened is that the very first thing that we see is that God didn't want man to partake of evil. He wanted them to be in his image and likeness, to reflect that to God, but without evil. And the very first indicator that we see of the whole shifting, a change in humanity, the very first shift, the change, resistance, wall, barrier, a change in humanity is in Genesis chapter 3. And one of the things that Bezalel, the great, or if you want to call him that, says is that he makes a distinction between the image and the likeness. And listen to this of what it says. The image is just that. Okay, an image. God took and formed man in from dust and created him in his image. So when you see man, you're seeing God, but you know, we haven't seen him. The epistle of John tells us that we shall see him as he is. We're going to see him in his fullness and his image. Another translation or another verse of scripture tells us that we shall know him as we are known of him. Now, feed on that for a little bit. What does that mean? We are going to know God, and when we see him in his fullness of who he is, his totality, if you will, that we're also going to see him in his fullness, but also that we're going to know him in the same way that he knows us. Would you agree with me today that God knows us? He knows everything. I think scripture where it says that, well, not scripture, but some of the theology will say that God is omnipresent, God is omniscient, and God is, there's one other one, omnipresent, omniscient, and I can't remember the other one. Well, those of you that are theologians, go ahead and post it on there, and I'll pick it up off of here. But those of you know exactly what I'm talking about. So he's all present, he's all knowing, and he's everywhere. But one of the things that we know about God is that we're in his very image. That's why sometimes, you know, with our kids, we'll say, boy, you look like your dad, you look like your mom, right? Even grandkids, wow, you look like your grandpa or your grandma, right? Like Angelina, my granddaughter. A lot of people tell her, you look like your grandpa, Grandpa Rudy, right? And I think she used to get bummed out at one time, but but there's actually a picture of me and her where she's kind of mimicking me when I had these sunglasses on a track that actually went to Hawaii and all over the Bay Area, where I'm wearing sunglasses. Somebody drew that and made it into a track. So that's the image, but the likeness. So the distinction that Basil is saying, the great, is the image is just that. Mankind is made in the image of God, whereas the likeness is a spiritual attribute of the moral qualities of God. However, the medieval distinction between the image and the likeness of God has largely been abandoned by modern interpreters. So somebody was writing and saying that, you know, many interpreters of, or nowadays, we've moved so far away. And man, the image, the likeness has become so distorted. You know, now is that, you know, people are modifying, changing, altering. I seen a picture of a guy that he was trying to look like a snake. And the things he was doing to his flesh, his ears were being reshaped and reformed. And he had, I don't know, like a bone or something going through his lips. And I mean, he was just reshaping. I think what it was is that, you know, here he was trying to distort. You know, sometimes you have people that, I hate God. I hate God for whatever reason. And man, they're trying to take the image, anything reflective of God, and corrupt and change that. And I think that we see that a lot. So from the garden throughout the years, here we are for thousands of years. What, Christ came into this world, over a couple thousand years ago. But and then creation goes way back, thousands of years, right? So we're talking thousands of years. So think about how much we lose of heritage, of who we are and all that. Some of us, like for example, myself, I had been tracking, you know, my dad's side, my family, just wanting to know more. I wish I was more interested in it when he was alive, but I wasn't. And, you know, so now I find myself that, man, who am I, this, that? I'm looking on ancestry and all this stuff and where we come from and just trying to, you know, get there. But my point is this, that we need to get back to God's purpose, God's plan for our life, his intent that he designed for us. And so that is very, very important to us today. So the likeness, the image of God. Let me see. I got one more thing here, and then we're going to read scripture. So we know that right away, after they partook the, and I'm talking about Adam and Eve now, after they partook of the fruit of the knowledge of good and evil, as soon as they had Cain and Abel, their seed, all of a sudden they're reflecting, they're pushing that seed. You know what I mean? Like Eve conceives, has a kid, and the very first thing that happens as they grow up is, boom, there's jealousy. But also I need to back up a little bit, and that is to say this. When God came to see what they had done or to check up on, follow up on them, guess what? They hid themselves. They hid themselves amongst the trees. They heard the voice of the Lord in the cool of the day. They heard his voice. They heard the Lord as they were used to, you know, communing and fellowshipping and walking with God. They were used to it. But the very first thing that we see that happens is that, man, for the first time, they are afraid and they hid themselves. And then, you know, why? Because they were they realized they were naked and they were ashamed. And something, this whole dynamic, something entered into them. The what I call the beginning of the corruption or corrupt image, you know, like a virus in your computer. It just, boom, it just haywire, does whatever, right? And so we know that there was a corruption, evil entered in. They realize they're naked, they're afraid. And when they heard the voice of God, they hid themselves. And, you know, and the very first thing we do is that separation, the image, the likeness of God, the separating, the wall, the hedge that came up on that. And so it's critical that we understand, because religion today has been made of everything other than looking at the biblical dynamics of what really happened. Now we put all kinds of stuff. Man, you got to this, you got to that, and you're not good. And that, I mean, man, oh, I hate it. But so what is the first thing that happens? That whole dynamic of fear and afraid. And the Lord told them that they, you know, don't eat of it. I just don't want you to be involved with any evil. And what happened? The human race took the virus of evil. God set it in the garden, said, don't mess with it. I don't want to introduce that to you. I don't want that integrated into your system, into your life. I want you to be able to live in my presence and not have any of this. And the very first thing, like I said already, boom, they hid themselves. They were ashamed. They realized they were naked. They had no covering. Something was missing. Boom, Adam and Eve come together. They have a kid, Cain. Then they have Abel. One becomes a tiller of the ground. And one is, you know, taking care of animals, sheep, and all that. And they both bring an offering to God. Abel brings an offering to the Lord of his first fruit, the sheep and all this. I don't know, there's something there to it. And what does Cain do? He brings from the ground. The ground is already, you know, cursed, so if you will. And he brings that, and the Lord didn't really look at his favorably. And boom, all of a sudden Cain is angry. So we see anger. Let me ask you a question. Prior to evil, do you think that Adam and Eve had any kind of anger issues or, you know, marital problems? I don't think so. But as soon as this is introduced, evil, into the image of and the likeness that we were created, all of a sudden, boom. So the result of that, now I want you to follow this, because it, Adam and Eve partake of it, and then the next second generation, the second generation is feeling the impact of the choice that they made to integrate and take into the image and the likeness that they were created in. They took in evil. And what do we see? That we see that Cain rose up against his brother Abel and he murdered him. Now, for the first time, we see the corrupted human being, humanity being corrupted. Now there's not only evil, there's fear, and all that plays into that fear, the separating from God, running, hiding from God, doing things, all this stuff to hide from God. And so what happens when you read the Bible, you find out, and the blood of Abel cried out to the Lord. His blood cried out. I believe that, you know, that God hears the innocent blood that has been shed since the beginning, since Abel. So nowadays, you know, of course, we went through some heavy stuff last year. 2020 was the craziest year, but yet it was the most eye-opening, because our intentions, our everything just surfaced to the root. Even Christianity, religion, all that, man, I'll tell you, we've seen all the junk that came out of it. And man, I'll tell you, I didn't want to get caught up with none of that. None of that. Sorry. Look to Jesus. Look to creation. Because, you know, when we live in that dynamic, what did Jesus come to do? I believe that he came to restore the very image likeness. So back to my point, and then I'm going to move on. Let me see, I'm running out of time. Back to the image. So what happened? The blood cries out. And so the first thing the Lord did was he had to take skins from an animal and he covered them up. So that's the first, that's really the first time you see that something has to change in the whole creation. Okay, so let's think about this. I want you to go, and the next scripture that I want to read to you, and of course you've seen it, I think, I'm sure I posted it up here, is found over in the book of Romans. Go with me to the book of Romans chapter 8, if you will. Romans chapter 8. And I want you to look at something here, because, you know, as we're talking about the image, you know, sometimes we got it wrong. We got such a, people are into superficial imaging. You know that movie stars, and not only movie stars, singers, performers, like one of my favorite shows is The Voice. Annette and I, we just love The Voice. But sometimes you get somebody that way over on the other side of the woods and way in the country somewhere. And man, the first thing that, you know, you find out is when they have a powerful voice, a moving voice, and man, a God gift voice, the very first thing they want to do is change their image. Why? Because that's the world for you. That's just the way it is. You got to have the right image. But we put preeminence, or we put more value on the exterior image, you know, a superficial type. But here in Romans 8:29, one of the things that the Bible tells us, and I want you to notice this from the scriptures, and I'm just going to read verse 28. Listen to this, and we know Romans 8:28, for those who love God, all things work together for good, for those who are called according to his purpose. That was verse 28. Then verse 29, Romans 8:29, for those whom he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his son. Now, I want you to underline that. Now, one of the things that we know that Jesus came to do is the reality is in the plan of God, you got to tie it in with Genesis 1:26. And then the ruined, corrupt image that brings fear, death, anxiety, confusion, your mind's not all there, all the stuff and all the crazy stuff, the darkness that we go through in our life. And I got to tell you, when I was 16 years old, I was ready to end my life because I thought I had lived life to its fullest. And man, I'm glad that I didn't end my life when I took an intentional drug overdose to end my life, because at 16, I was done with life. But why is that? Because of the corrupt image, the image and the likeness of what I was seeing and what was being portrayed. I just see no light at the end of the tunnel. And I got to tell you, till Jesus came. Man, for this purpose was the Son of God manifested, to undo, to destroy, to unravel the work of the wicked one, the evil one. This is why Jesus came. If Acts 10:38, the scripture tells us how that Jesus went about doing good and healing all that were oppressed of the devil. Can I get a witness? Can I get an amen to that one? Here's looking at you today. God bless you. And listen to this. So we need to jump from Genesis to right here, the very purpose. I think that Paul, writing to the Romans, and man, it's interesting because you need to understand that if you were in Rome, you got to know, man, that there was gods, there was images. And something interesting that I had read was how that in those days, the kings, and you know, I'm talking thousands of years ago, how that those that were in authority, rulers, actually would make images of themselves. Remember, we even find where the Bible says that, you know, they came to Jesus and said, Jesus, shall we pay taxes? I hope not. No, you better pay your tax. I don't want you to get in trouble. But they said, Lord, shall we pay taxes? They were trying to trip them up. They say, here, give me a coin. He gets the coin, and I had one around here at one time, somewhere. But they give him a coin, and Jesus says, come on, somebody tell me, what did Jesus say to them? Whose what is on this coin? Whose image is on this coin? And that's really what the Lord said to him. Whose image is on this coin? So, you know, that's why I'm saying to you that authority, power, and all this stuff was already like kings and authority and all that. They exercised that, and they wanted their image of power and authority and all this stuff. But Jesus takes the coin. He says, whose image is in this? Whose impression is this? And so that told us, and they said, Caesar's. Well, what did Jesus say? Well, give to Caesar what belongs to Caesar, and give to God what belongs to God. Detach yourself from the image of the world and all that, in the sense of, your likeness of God and the image of what God created us to be way back in the day. Somebody put that scripture up, if you don't mind. But my point is that the very image and impression is left there. So what did Romans tell us? So that's why Paul, as he's writing to them, man, he understands what they're facing, man. He understands the culture. He understands the challenge. He understands the pressure that is being put on the followers of Christ, that in the shadows, the people of God in the shadow or under the shadow of the authorities, the powers that be, they're constantly being put and driven to the place of pain and worshiping this image, right? You know, you could reference the book of Daniel, right? Why did the three Hebrews get thrown in the fiery furnace? Why? Because there was a created an image. And of course, they were trying to trip up the man of God, the holy people of God, those that were committed to God, those that were giving their life to the Lord. What happened? There was an image created after the king of that day. And they said, when you hear the music, you hear the rock and roll, you hear whatever. I'm not trying to knock rock and roll. I love rock and roll. I love all kinds of music. And don't ding me for it. And even if you do, I'm still going to listen to it. I don't care. But what happened? They said, when you hear the music, bow down. And then it was all a conspiracy. Now, that was a conspiracy. It was a conspiracy to attack Daniel, the three Hebrews, and to get them out of authority, out of power. Why? Because God had given Daniel so much influence and so much favor. And we know, praise God, that, man, he's giving revelation, dreams, this, that. He's dedicated to God. But my point is that image. So what does the Bible say? The reason I said all of that, I don't want to lose track of it. The reason I said all that, because the book of Romans, as he's writing this to them, he understands the challenge, the dynamics of being a follower of Christ, of being in the image of God in the midst of all these images. We know that Paul also, when he went to Athens, and as he was there on Mars Hill, what does he see, man? All these idols, all these images. And then, boom, there's even one to the unknown God. And what is he doing, man? He's pointing them. He's saying to them, man, let me tell you about the... I see that you guys are devout. I see that you are committed. I see that you are religious. But let me tell you about the unknown God. Let me direct your attention to the one who made the heavens and the earth, the one who sent his son in his own image and likeness, that he has walked this earth. Let me tell you about him who God has raised from the dead. And he preached Jesus to them. So that's why in Romans 8:29, I want you to look at that as you look at this and as you consider this. Man, what a powerful verse of scripture that really is. And I'm going to see if I could actually post it. No, you know, last week when I had my, iPad, I would copy something on my desktop and boom, I could actually post. It was crazy. Anyways, Romans 8:29. Read it, mark it down. Somebody put that scripture up there and let me see. I'm going to see if somebody's already got it up there. God bless you guys today, man. I appreciate. Laura, thank you for putting Romans 8:29. Anybody got the whole scripture? Thank you for doing that. But I don't know if there's a way that I could post while I'm doing this here. Put the whole scripture. And what does it say? For those whom he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his son, in order that he might be the firstborn among many brethren. Now, it's so important. Remember this. In John 14, write this scripture down. John 14, verses 8 and 9. And I'll repeat it again. John 14, verses 8 and 9. Remember there where Jesus, you know, he's speaking and he's letting them know, you believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions, etc., etc. And but he begins to talk about the way. I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes unto the Father but by me, right? But something that he says, and thank you so much. I don't know who posted it, but okay, Marianne, thank you, sis, for whom he for God knew his people in advance. This is the New Living Testament. Thank you, Marianne. And chose them to become like the Son, so that his Son would be the firstborn among many brothers and sisters, a new creation, if you will. And I love the way that the ESV and also the King James brings it out. It just simply says that in the image that we have been predestined. So it was God's intent, God's plan from way back in the garden that we would be restored back to the image of his son. And then, so what do we see? John 14, 8 and 9. I didn't forget the scripture. And thank you, Laura, for putting it up there. Is this, Philip said to the Lord, Lord, show us the Father. All right. Listen to this. Show us the Father and it is enough for us. And this is ESV Bible. Jesus said to him, have I been so long with you and still you do not know me, Philip? I can tell you that there's many of us that have walked with God and have been in God, and man, we still have a distorted view, I'm just saying, of what God's trying to do from the beginning, because religion and denominationalism, if you will, has crept in and all kinds of stuff. Galatians, Paul writes to him and he says, who has bewitched you, right? Who put the brujerías on you, right? And why? Because he's saying, man, having begun in the spirit, are you now being made perfect by the law? And so he was making the point to the Galatians that, boy, you guys started out good, but somehow this stuff has crept in. In the book of Jude, he gives us also to remind us that, you know, that we need to fight, contend for the faith. And just the whole notion, the idea, there's so many ideologies and thoughts and all that come in that we deter and we go away. And even what I'm saying now can be, you know, some will say the same. But let me tell you, John 14, 8 and 9. So what is he saying? What did Philip say? Lord, show us the Father. And then Jesus' point is this. You still don't know me, Philip? I've been with you for a long time. He'd been with them, around him for 3 years solid, day in, day night. And he's saying to a man, and you still don't know me. Man, listen to this. And what does he say to him? He said, whoever has seen me has seen the Father. How can you say, show us the Father? Man, so what we see here is, you know, Jesus came from the Father, and they're really seeing the image, the unbroken, uncorrupted image and likeness of God. When they're looking at Jesus, they're seeing the image and the likeness of God that was lost in Genesis chapter 3. And man, for me, this is powerful, this whole idea of what Jesus is coming and doing. And I'm about to close off. It's 11:06. Oh my God. But let's read another scripture. So we know from the book of Romans, and just hang with me tight, everybody. Just one more scripture. And for that one, let's write this down. Just write this down. And if somebody wants to put it up there, I appreciate you guys that are putting the scripture up there. Thank you so much, you guys. Let me see. Because, you know, there's some powerful verses of scripture. We know that, in, like I said earlier, Romans, it's been the intent, the purpose of the Father that we be conformed to the image of Christ. You know, that's why, you know, a lot of people will quote Romans 12. They'll say things like, don't be conformed to this world. And boom, they'll start telling you all these little things. And the reality is, they're saying is, allow yourself, you know, through the renewing of your mind, that you'll be able to be in the image and the likeness of Christ. The restored image, likeness of Christ. How? By the power that he was raised from the dead, and through the power of the Holy Spirit, now working in us. Amen. 1 Corinthians 15:49 and 50 said, just as we have been born, just as we have borne the image of the man of dust. This is 1 Corinthians 15:49 and 50. 1 Corinthians 15:49 and 50. Just as we have borne the image of the man of dust, we shall also bear the image of the man of heaven. Wow, my God. Somebody's got to put that verse up there. Let me see if there's a way for me to put it up there. Man, this is meat. Sometimes you got people, oh man, we need meat. I need more. I need somebody to prophesy over me and rub the hair off my head and da 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 da. But 1 Corinthians 15:49 and 50, if we can't even get this straight, forget about all the other stuff. Because, you know, until we get this straight, we're not going to grow the way we should, I think. I say. So what does he say? Just as we have borne the image of the man of dust. Thank you, sis, for putting that. Bore the image of the earthly man. Thank you. And I think that's... Oh, okay. Thanks, Marianne. So the New Living Testament says, just as we have borne the image of the earthly man, so shall we also bear the image of the heavenly man. I declare to you, brothers and sisters, flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, nor does the perishable inherit the imperishable. Thank you, Marianne and Laura, for putting that on there. But that's what powerful, powerful scripture. Colossians 1:12 let me tell you this one. Colossians 1:15 says, talking about Christ, how that he delivered us from the domain of darkness. He transferred us to the kingdom of his beloved Son, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins. And verse 15, Colossians 1:15 says, he is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation. Then verse 16 says, for by him all things were created in heaven and earth, visible, invisible, whether thrones or dominions, rulers or authorities, all things were created through him and for him. Amen. Verse 17 says that he is before all things, and in him are all things. All things are held together, and he is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that in everything he might be preeminent. For in him all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell, and through him to reconcile to himself all things. Reconciliation has to start right here with us. Then we could talk about it on a global scale, on the racial scale, etc., etc. And what does it say in Colossians 1:20? And through him to reconcile to himself all things, whether on earth or in heaven, making peace by the blood of Christ. Amen. Last scripture, I promise you, then I'm closing. And my sisters, if you don't mind putting this up, Colossians 3, verse 10. Colossians 3, verse 10. And this is where I'm going to close, I promise. Oops, my button came undone. No, I undid it. I was feeling choked. All right, listen to this one, Colossians 3. And thank you, sister, praise God, for putting Colossians 1:15, the image. Thank you, appreciate that. And now Colossians 3, verse 10, listen to this one. And he's simply saying that we have, and put on the new self, putting on this new self, which is being renewed. Listen to that being. So it's a, what's that word? Not a pronoun, but you know, it's a word of active or continuous action is when you look at this word, and put on the new self, which is being renewed. So there is a processing, I should say, of this image and likeness that as we have been covered in the blood and through the breaking of his body and through the working of the Holy Spirit, we're being renewed in the knowledge after the image of his creator. And man, what a powerful verse of scripture, you guys. And I think that's going to be it. I'm going to read also that because Marianne's, she put the King James on 120, having made peace through the blood of his cross, by him to reconcile all things unto himself. By him, I say, whether they be things on heaven and or on earth. Amen. Also, so put on the new man, Colossians 3:10, put on the new man, which is renewed in the knowledge after the image of him that created him. This is why it is important for us to stay in the Word of God. Amen. Let's pray. If you don't know the Lord, if you haven't embraced him by faith, doesn't matter where you're at, what you've done, he loves you, he cares about you, he will save you, he will heal you in Jesus' name. Let's pray. Father, we thank you. Bless each and every one that is hearing today, Father. Lord, that we are being renewed in the likeness, the image that you created us from the very beginning of Genesis 1:26. And Lord, that image that we've seen that was reflected here on earth through your son Jesus. And Lord, as he was raised from the dead and through the power of the Holy Spirit, even now, you're renewing us through your word, through your spirit. And Father, it is demonstrated in the toughness, in the opposition of life, in all that that applies and comes against us, Father, the image and likeness of God is shining through. And Lord, I pray for those today that are sick, afflicted, those that have lost loved ones, we bless you. I pray for my sister, Latricia and Brad, for healing from COVID, and anybody out there, put your prayer requests on here, and God bless you all so much. Good to see you on here. Let me see. Joe Tovar, the Lord bless you, man. Good teaching yesterday. The Brewliners, thank you so much, my brother. God bless you guys. I'm going to play a song here for you guys. This is a Van Morrison song. I might get dinged and kicked off Facebook at the very end. I don't know why Gilbert Escoville plays all kinds of music. They don't kick him out as much as me. No, he gets kicked out too, but check it out. This is a Van Morrison song called The Palace of the Lord. You didn't know Van Morrison sings some good stuff. I'm going to be putting your posts up there. Be blessed in Jesus' name. Don't forget, you've been created in the image and the likeness of God, and you are being renewed daily. Amen. God bless you.
You were reading on your sofa. From the loneliness of the crowd.